Hi, I'm David Yang, founder of Fullstack Academy, and today we're talking about why does Fullstack Academy teach Fullstack JavaScript? Now we're standing here in 2019, and the answer looks pretty obvious in hindsight, but in 2012, it was a bit of a crazy thing for us to do, and I'll talk about why we did it then, and why we think it's still the right answer for you now if you're considering learning a new programming language, or going to a coding bootcamp, and how to factor the language that coding bootcamp teaches into your decision. So when we started Fullstack Academy in 2012, we were looking around at what people were trying to learn, and everyone was really trying to learn Ruby on Rails. Now, don't get me wrong, I love Ruby on Rails. I spent a lot of my career doing Ruby on Rails, and in fact, worked for a long time in Ruby on Rails and did a lot of companies in Ruby on Rails that did very well. So I love Ruby on Rails, but when we started writing curriculum, we came to this really big road bump, right? We said we want to do the best thing for students to get them to a job in 3 months. Right, and then we're writing out the curriculum outline. We're saying we're going to do a little bit of Ruby on Rails and a little bit of JavaScript. And the reality is that you just have to do JavaScript if you want to be a software engineer, especially a web application software engineer in 2012 and definitely now. So we were one of the first schools to go out and say, you know what? We're not going to do Ruby on Rails. We're going to just teach you JavaScript. And we're going to use a technology that no one's heard of back then in 2012 called Node.js. So very early on, as soon as we launched, we were like, okay, full stack JavaScript, just teach JavaScript all the way from the beginning. And we wanted people to learn one language and be really good at it rather than be forced to learn the ecosystem with two languages. So why JavaScript? Back then, and even now, it's really easy to get started with JavaScript. The thing that you're watching this video on right now is running JavaScript. You can hit probably Command Alt J, and you'll open up a JavaScript engine right in your browser. So your browser's running JavaScript, it's really easy to get started. You can open up the console and all of a sudden be typing JavaScript, you're good to go. Now there's sites like JSBin, REPL.IT, where you can go and start programming JavaScript immediately. And even something like Google Sheets. Google Sheets behind the scenes lets you program in JavaScript to extend the functionality of your spreadsheet. So everywhere, you wanna get started with JavaScript, it's available in so many different things. And the second thing we love about JavaScript is that you can really build applications soup to nuts, top to bottom, across the whole stack, and that's why we call it full stack, with just JavaScript. So in 2013, we had a curriculum where we were doing JavaScript in the browser, JavaScript on the server using a technology called Node.js, and using JavaScript in the database even using something called MongoDB. Modern day, we've changed a few of those things, but we still use Node on the server. We use JavaScript in the browser, and our students still get really good at JavaScript and use it across the entire curriculum. And one thing we hear from employers is that they'd rather have someone who knows one thing really well than two or three things not so well. So, take it from us, employers really like that you know one thing well. The second thing is, it's a little bit of a culture difference between, I would say, the Rails community and the JavaScript community. And this is gonna sound biased, but just my impression, right, is that in the Rails community, you get a little bit of this archaeology culture, and in the JavaScript community, you get a little bit of this modular architecture culture, right? So do you wanna learn as an architect, or do you wanna learn as the archaeologist? And what I mean by that is that as an archaeologist, you're kind of like digging yourself around all this mud and trying to find out, how do people do these things? Why do they do it? And you get a lot of value out of it. As soon as you uncover something like the Parthenon, you're like, wow, now I understand columns, now I understand, triangles and arches and all these things. You get a lot of value by understanding how these best practices came to be. In JavaScript, it's almost the exact opposite. They give you very small little Lego blocks, and you had to put them together. And a lot of times, people in JavaScript community will say, oh, this is terrible, because I have to figure out all these things to put together, I have to connect all these bricks, and I don't know what I'm doing, right? And now, that being said, when you're building applications, that can be problematic, but when you're learning, we think that's really good, right? Because you know how all the pieces are, you know where they connect, you know where they come from, and you're using small pieces, putting them together, and we just think it's better for learning and better for being a person who knows how things work. I hear so many times from students, I'm learning Rails, I type something like, belongs to this other thing, and it's setting up my database, it's connecting these columns together, it's giving me this stuff in my form. Where did all this stuff come from, right? I'm an archaeologist, I'm digging it out, I'm trying to figure out what's going on. Now, in JavaScript, you don't get any of that. So if you like that of like, I'm learning this all by myself, I'm putting it together for the first time, it's great. It's great from a learning standpoint. So the culture is just different. I call it the architect versus archaeology culture. And finally, I think just the employment side of JavaScript has been strong, and now it's so dominant. I can't even describe what it feels like to, in 2019, how dominant JavaScript has taken over the industry, right? So, if you look at the GitHub language ranking, the Tyobi ranking, the Red Monk rank, all these rankings, JavaScript is consistently number one if you're a language snob, you might be like, oh my god, my goodness, why is JavaScript taking over the world? And the answer is that it's kind of like, why did English take over the world, right? Because JavaScript attached itself to the browser, and the browser has been the biggest engine for technology in the last 20 years, right? So JavaScript and the browser rode their way to global world domination, and that's why JavaScript is just happens to be everywhere. The other story is that a lot of these browser companies like Google, Firefox, Microsoft really invested in JavaScript as a language and in JavaScript the engine. So now JavaScript, not only is it everywhere, but it's also quite fast. The other reason that I think for employment it's really great for people who learn JavaScript right now is that the community is still very much in flux, right? And so one thing about, you know, you join a community, not only do you have skills, but you also are part of what's changing the community, right? And so when there's a lot of change early in your career, that can be great, because what that means is that no one's an expert, right? So for example, one of the top technologies in JavaScript right now, front-end JavaScript, is React, right? React is a very hidden technology. People are still trying to figure out how to do it. And so you go to a company, you know, there's no React experts, there's no like 10-year React career training program. It's just whoever can do it is the expert now. So I think if that's appealing to you, if you like a little bit of chaos, but in return for that chaos, you can move in your career very quickly, JavaScript and high-tech stuff and its chaotic nature is a great choice right now. And in terms of employment, the other reason JavaScript is great is because of something called this person, Jeff Atwood, coined the term Atwood's Law. And the law goes something like this. If something can run a programming language, eventually it will run JavaScript. And the idea is that JavaScript just tends to be a language that's it's really well designed for beginners. And because it's so prevalent, everybody tends to want to put a JavaScript engine into that technology. So where do you see that? You can use JavaScript now in React Native to build mobile apps. You can use it in things like Google Sheets. You can use it on something called Tessel. These are little microcontrollers that run, you know, that connect to like temperature sensors, kind of like Arduino, but runs JavaScript. So JavaScript is, for better or worse, just everywhere. So that creates a lot of opportunities for people who are good at JavaScript to work on technologies beyond just a browser. And of course, with things like Node.js, you can use JavaScript, one language, front end, which everybody needs, right? Everyone needs to have a web application these days. You can use a server to do your business applications, your business logic, and you can use a database too with Mongo, you know, and it's just one technology that's kind of a little bit like Sauron, you know, one language to rule them all. That's why JavaScript has become dominant. That's why we still use it, and our students see great results with it. They build great projects. They achieve great placement outcomes, and that's why we picked JavaScript in 2013. It was a bit of a gamble then, and it's really paid off, and I think it continues to be a great thing for us now and for our students.